in the crossfire. Howard Dean, who supports the Democrats, and Jesse Ventura, who'd furlough both parties' lawmakers. Solving the shutdown. What can taxpayers do tonight on Crossfire?
Welcome to Crossfire. I'm Stephanie Cutter on the left.
I'm Ezzy Cupp on the right. Whether it was a mistake or they meant it, the White House signaling to the Wall Street Journal that they don't care how long this shutdown goes on, as long as they're winning, is a huge problem. Blaming Republicans may be good for business right now, but the American people have a short memory. If the White House doesn't lead soon, they'll find themselves in big trouble.
Well, you know, Essie, the president and every Democratic member of Congress have made it clear that nobody wins in a shutdown. Mm-hmm. 800,000 unemployed federal workers not getting a paycheck, kids not being able to go to Head Start programs, people not being able to get their mortgages or their small business loans. It's a disaster.
It is.
And Speaker Boehner is trying to blame the president. And that's like, you know, you set your house on fire and then you blame the fire department when it burns down.
The buck has to stop somewhere.
It does. And it could stop right now. Speaker Boehner could bring the bill to the floor and pass it with bipartisan votes. Enough is enough. We can get this over with. Anyway, in the crossfire tonight, two former governors, Democrat Howard Dean and Independent Jesse Ventura. He's the author of They Killed Our President. Governor Ventura, the first question goes to you. You called for a political revolution.
Yes.
And what you mean by that is the American people should stop electing Democrats and Republicans.
Absolutely.
That's a very similar message to the Tea Party. Are you a member of the Tea Party?
Absolutely.
And what advice would you give them to be more inclusive?
I'm a member of no party, and I advocate for the abolishment of all political parties. And my allies are George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, and John Adams. Let's abolish political parties, make them political action committees. You could still get endorsed by a political party. Mm-hmm. And where we could start, why do they put the political party's name on an election ballot? Why not just the name of the candidate? See, it's far too easy. Mm-hmm. If you're conservative, you don't need to know who it is. You look for Republican. If you're liberal, you look for Democrat. This way, it's inherent upon the voter to educate themselves. What does John Smith stand for when I go in to vote? Let's remove party off the ballot labels. That's a great start. It can be done locally in all the states could start it, and it could spread like wildfire.
Governor Dean, in 2011, you spoke about the potential shutdown then. You had this to say: I wouldn't like a shutdown from a statesman point of view, but if I were the head of the DNC, I would be quietly rooting for it. I think a lot of Democrats are quietly rooting for the shutdown right now and thinking that it's good business. Where are you on this shutdown?
I think the president's right. A lot of people are getting hurt. Here's what the problem is. These compromises can be made. They're not supposed to be made by stamping your foot and refusing to fund the government. These bills were incurred by the people who are now refusing to vote to do something. The bills have already been, the money's been spent, and it was approved by Republicans and Democrats. So for the Republicans to say, we're not going to fund our debts that we already incurred so that you can give up some more stuff that we couldn't get out of you in the normal elective process, in the normal legislative process, it's silly, it's childish, and it's not in the best interest of the country.
But on the debt ceiling, most Americans agree that they want it attached to spending cuts. If most Americans can understand that fundamentally attaching to the debt ceiling spending cuts is a reasonable thing to do, why isn't the president listening to American people, if not Congress?
Because I think it's not so easy to understand how the budget works. And if the debt ceiling is not agreed upon and doesn't get raised, I think we're spending too much money. I'm a deficit hawk. But if you don't fund our bills, you are going to precipitate not just an American economic collapse, but a worldwide economic
collapse. Isn't it a false argument? We're not talking about not funding our bills. We'll fund our bills, and we want spending cuts.
Well, you know, certainly you can have your cake and eat it, too. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Why can't we do both? Well, first of all, I'd like to say both of these parties are responsible for this massive debt. They've been in charge for 150 years. How do they run from that? And they've, in fact, if they ran their home finances the way they've run the government finances, they'd be bagless, homeless people living on the street right now.
So
sounds pretty good to me. Can't we just give them the heave-ho?
Yeah.
I think that's what the American people think, too. But back to whether or not Congress should vote on a clean debt ceiling increase to pay for to make good on their debts, as Governor Dean said, that they've already obligated the American people to. Do you think that we should be playing games with that? Should we have a clean debt limit bill?
Absolutely. I've always been one to advocate all bills should be clean.
Right.
Enough of this nonsense of amendment to bills. I worked hard for my 4 years in Minnesota, and had I sought reelection, mm-hmm. I wanted unicameral, single house at the state level. Because in a single house legislature, if they're going to make an amendment to a bill, it has to go out to the full floor for a vote before it can be amended on the bill. Many times you may have a great bill, mm-hmm. and then they put three or four horrible amendments on it, and that puts you in the predicament. Mm-hmm. Do I pass the original good bill with three horrible things attached to it? I think everything should be clean. Let's end amendments to all bills unless they apply to that specific subject.
I don't actually agree with doing that, but with the basic principle that Jesse's talking about is a very smart principle, because what has happened is the Congress in particular, and Washington in particular, although it happens to a certain degree in state capitals, has become all about the members of Congress. Now, the fact is, those seats don't belong to the members of Congress. They think they do. Mm-hmm. They belong to the people who put them there. Yeah. And that's the real problem. And things have got to be changed dramatically. And I am looking for some really dramatic changes, and I'm willing to entertain some of these ideas that have not been considered mainstream ideas, because I think the system is clearly broken.
Well, at the federal level, you need two houses. I'm not saying unicameral at the federal level. I'm speaking only at the state level.
No, but the amendment stuff I thought was very interesting.
Yeah,
because, here's a guy can't, or a gal can't get something done. They make a deal, so they tax something on some, and the bill is so important that they can't say no to the bill, so something that most people don't want gets in the bill. It's classic.
Well, it's also how the government shut down. That's how we got this government shut down.
Yeah. But I do think that financial stuff has to be off limits. You cannot fiddle with the credit of the United States, and you cannot fiddle with whether we ought to pay our debts, this is the thing that drives me crazy. Boehner's been speaker for, 3 years? He's incurred these things. They passed continuing resolutions with Republican votes. This is their bill, and they refuse to pay it.
But do you think President Obama is going to let the country default just so that he doesn't give Republicans what they want? He won't.
It's not up to him. Congress has to pass the bill.
Here's the problem. You cannot put this in the legislative mess.
Yeah.
You cannot. He's absolutely not going to compromise. This is not about compromise. Okay. This is about the core principle is, do you refuse to pay the bills to get your way? That's what this is about. There is no compromise here.
Do you think
there are things you can do, but not in the universe of the debt ceiling or the continuing resolution?
And do you agree with that also?
Absolutely.
That we shouldn't be playing games with it? The last time we played games with it, it cost us $1 trillion.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. And it shows me, too, that in the typical fashion, these two parties, they put their party first, they put their money people second of who contributes to them and pays them off in the system of bribery. Mm. And we, the people, might be third. Something else could sneak in front of us, too, maybe.
I'll tell a 2-second story. So
I
do a lot of work abroad, and I do work in Ukraine.
Yeah.
And so I get an appointment with the chief of staff of the president of Ukraine, who's not exactly Mr. Democrat, shall we say. So the chief of staff is terrific, though. She's an economics professor. She's really very fluent in English. So I'm explaining to her why it's not such a good job to get too close, good thing to get too close to the Russians, because you have to watch out, and why we need them to be more transparent, because they don't want to end up like Belarus. You know, I'm sticking them all the nerves. And then I start in on lecturing them on campaign funding, and I start in explaining them why they shouldn't allow oligarchs to fund campaigns. And then I go, I'm really sorry, Madam Chief of Staff, but I can't give this because our court just legalized oligarchs running American parties.
Exactly.
Calling the kettle.
And to me, what should happen there is I'm for unlimited campaign finance, just open disclosure, and it should all go directly to the candidate. Mm-hmm. None of these outside entities playing the game. That way the candidate's responsible. Like, say I ran, and let's say, for example, Vince McMahon wanted to give me $1 million.
Yeah.
That's fine as long as I openly disclose so that the public knows, well, he's going to be doing a few favors for Vince McMahon, or he's doing a few favors for Mark Cuban, who's a friend of mine, if they were to do that sort of thing. So I'm not for any limitation as far as that goes, but there must be full open disclosure, and it should be in the candidate who is responsible for that disclosure of every cent spent.
I'm on the other end of that spectrum. I'm public financing and strict limits is what you can say, but I also agree that these PACs have that corporations are not people. And if they are, let them pay the same income tax bracket that everybody else pays.
Mm-hmm. So back to the fight that's going here in Washington. Governor Ventura, you have been in the ring and have had your share of fights.
All kinds of ring.
Well, remember now, though, that's ballet with violence.
Okay, fair enough.
That's how I describe my former profession of 23 years ago.
Vince McMahon's years ago.
It's called ballet with violence.
Okay. Well, do you think the fight that Republicans are trying to wage now, shutting down the government over Obamacare, was worth it? Is this a fight
Absolutely
they should abandon?
Not. I mean, let's look at these Democrats and Republican elected congressmen and senators. They get an option, they themselves, of four health care plans they get to choose from. And they won't let the people of America even have one? I mean, how they get there, I don't care. But my belief of this great country is if you're sick, you should have the ability to go to the doctor. Mm-hmm. It is that simple. However they want to deem to pay for it, but that should be our lifestyle here that we should work for. Because we're allegedly supposed to be the greatest country in the world, and yet we have people that, when they're ill, can't even go to the doctor.
So I'll answer your question in a different way. Is this worth it for the Republicans to do this? So Democracy for America, which came out of my campaign, is now run by my brother, has had a campaign for the last 2 days. They have signed up over 1 million people to make phone calls to get rid of the people who are blocking the government.
Mm-hmm.
A million people.
I'm on that
That's
list.
That's pretty. Are you? Yeah, you're on the DFA list. Huh?
Yeah. Okay. Governor Ventura, you may remember this commercial from 1998, your race for governor in 1998. Coming up. Welcome back to Crossfire. We're 4 days into the government shutdown. And amid all the angry rhetoric, here's something refreshing to see. Some advice from one of my favorite, rock star Bono, to CNN's Fareed Zakaria.
You know, we only had one idea, really, our organization won, which was to work with both sides, not to be held hostage by ideology on the left or the right, but actually to find a radical center, not a soft center, a tough-minded center, but that's been our strategy.
In the crossfire, we have Howard Dean and Jesse Ventura. So it's Friday, the end of a very long week here in Washington. I think the American people are pretty angry. The government is shut down, not working for them. Governor, you've even said that we shouldn't pay taxes.
I believe that since the government is partially shut down, they should be prorating our taxes. Yeah. So at the end of the year, we get a reduction for however many days it's shut down, because we're paying for goods and services we're not receiving.
I love that idea. Howard Dean, would you agree?
Technically, no, but yeah. I'll go you one better.
Yes.
The only reason is because the cost of ramping down and ramping back up would eat up. But here's what I think.
But philosophically, you're kind of into it.
Well, I'll tell you what I believe. I don't believe they should be paid.
Mm. Oh, absolutely
I don't see why they should
not.
Get one. These guys should get a single paycheck while nobody else is.
Well, and a number of them, we pointed out,
this is certainly not an essential service, believe me.
Right, and a number of them are donating their pay, and that's become something of a political...
Are they really?
I mean, they say they are, to charity.
Well, then, good. When they go to do it, let's have them show on their tax return that they donated their pay and to whom.
Okay.
Probably donating their pay to their wife.
You know, Governor Dean, you're a physician, and I remember back in 1993, 20 years ago, you said that being a physician gave you a healthy distrust of bureaucracy. I think that is fascinating, considering where we are today. Isn't letting government panels decide what kind of health care you need, isn't that really scary bureaucracy?
Yeah, but there's not really that. It doesn't really exist. It exists in some ways, and I've written about it.
Yep.
And I don't think that ought to be in the bill. It's one of the things in the bill I didn't like.
The iPad.
Mm-hmm. But that's pretty high-end technical stuff.
Right.
And the reason I don't like it is because it's not going to work. But that's not the, I'm for this bill going through. I think, you know, what we voted for, or what the Congress voted for, is essentially a core decision to leave, to have universal health care, but to leave it in the private sector. That's
but it's mandated.
Yeah, it's that's right. It's, there's an individual mandate. I wasn't for that. I wasn't for that either. But for a long series of very complicated reasons.
Yeah.
But what they've done is a system that could work. There aren't any cost controls. Okay, they need that needs to be done. And the way to do that is to get rid of fee-for-service medicine. This is a very long, complicated discussion, which I know you're not going to have here. You get the reason you need to get rid of fee-for-service medicine is we get paid to do as much as we possibly can. We don't get paid to keep you healthy. We only get paid when you really get sick. That is a crazy system. Mm. So, but there are things that can happen with this, with Obamacare. They're going to be good. First of all, you're already seeing a whole lot of people who really were in trouble able to get insurance. Second of all,
we don't know how many yet, actually.
We don't know how many.
A lot of people visited the website. We don't know how many people actually bought the product.
We've heard anecdotal stories. That's right. So that's a good thing. Secondly, we know this model works because it worked in Massachusetts.
That's
no
right.
cost controls, but 98.5% of all the people under Governor Romney had health insurance. So I think this thing ought to be tried. I think there'll be some improvements as we go along. But this is what we chose. This is what we chose in the democratic process. I didn't get my way.
Yeah.
I would have allowed lots of anybody who wanted to sign up for Medicare.
Yeah.
That didn't happen. I didn't win. But this is going to do some good things. And the private sector is going to be innovative and create something out of this that's going to work.
Do you think that President Obama's been an effective leader through this mess from Obamacare and the shutdown now to the debt ceiling? Has he been an effective leader on this?
Well, I would probably have done the same thing because I wouldn't allow myself to be forced into doing something like what they're trying to do. And you know, when it gets to the health care issue, I'm certainly not an expert like the doctor is. I listen to him to help learn what is this all about.
What's ailing you, yeah.
Yeah, and so I'll learn from him on that. But it just seems to me, come on, out of all the industrialized nations in the world, we are the only one that doesn't have health care. Let me read something from my book that applies to this. And I'll get it quickly. I should have really marked it right away. But, and it's very, very, okay, listen to this. There's absolutely no evidence to support the statement that we're the greatest country in the world. We're 7th in literacy, 27th in math, 22nd in science, 49th in life expectancy, 178th in infant mortality, 3rd in median household income, 4th in labor, 4th in experts. We lead the world in only 3 categories. The number of incarcerated citizens per capita. So we have the most people in jail, yet we're home of the brave, land of the free. The number of adults who believe angels are real. And finally, defense spending, where we spent more than the next 26 countries combined, 25 of whom are our allies. Let's cut defense spending a little bit, stay out of wars, and we'll have more than enough money to ensure everybody in this nation of health care.
Governor, your response?
I was reluctantly for the sequester because it would cut defense spending. The reason the defense spending should be cut, we probably don't have all that similar views on what how defense spending ought to go, but I think we can agree that there's an enormous bloated bureaucracy in the Pentagon, and here's what happens. The defense industry is smart. They have plants in a huge number of districts of the Congress people. This is a bipartisan problem. They don't get cut. The generals go and tell the president, no matter who the president is or who the generals are, that if you don't put this weapon system in, we could get blown up tomorrow by XYZ. What president's going to say, I don't believe you?
Yep.
So, I think.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
Is this a declaration?
No, but I would say I don't believe that.
Yeah. So I clearly think that they need to be under the same budgetary constraints as everybody else because there is waste, and I'm perfectly happy to let them pick out what the waste is. Mm-hmm. But there's clearly waste. Mm-hmm.
So I want to talk about a pretty incredible moment that was caught on mic this week, an open mic this week that explains why we're not reaching some of the goals that you laid out, why we're not doing the best that we can. Let's watch.
I think if we keep saying we wanted to defund it, we fought for that, but now we're willing to compromise on this, I think they can't. I mean, we're going to win. I know we don't want to be here, but we're going to win this, I think.
So that's Senator Rand Paul telling the minority leader in the Senate, don't compromise. Keep the government shut down until we can defund Obamacare. That sums up the problem we have here in Washington, doesn't it?
I think so, especially on this particular issue. And like I said, it's already been passed. It's the law.
That's right.
How can these guys defy the law? The law is passed. Both houses passed it.
You think they're afraid it's
going to work?
The Supreme
Court said okay.
Yeah, the president signed it, and the Supreme Court said it's fine.
Do you think they're afraid of it working?
Yes. And the thing they need to remember, this is Obama's legacy. So if it's so bad, why don't they hang him with it?
You don't think there's a contingent of Republicans who fundamentally believe that Obamacare is a moral hazard that will bankrupt the country?
I think
you don't believe that there's any authenticity anywhere?
I think these wars will bankrupt the country more than Obamacare.
It's a fair point, but it's another question.
And I bet you they would all vote to go to war, wouldn't they? Iraq, they had no problem.
Every Republican who opposes Obamacare does so simply because it has the president's name on it and because they actually think it will work.
I actually think that there are probably a few people worried about the deficit. I think they're on the Republican Party. There's such a hatred of Barack Obama that, in fact, they are motivated more by hate than what's good for this country.
Do you think that that's a productive thing to say, though? I mean, let's talk about rhetoric. We have Democrats calling Tea Partiers anarchists and jihadists. Harry Reid actually apologized today for the lack of civility. What good does that kind of rhetoric do when we're all trying to get to a place of compromise and agreement?
Because it's the truth. I've never been in a scene before in politics where there was a whole crew of people on the Republican side or any side who denied that the president of the United States was an American citizen. You got to call this what it is. This is hate. It's anti-immigrant. They're anti-gay. They're anti-secularist. And I don't think we can give it.
Well, let me just show you as just a point of evidence here. I am a Republican who is an atheist, who is pro-gay rights, pro-gay marriage.
Sure.
And there are plenty like me.
There are plenty like me.
And it's incredibly irresponsible for you to paint an entire party, and in fact, more than half the country, with that kind of brush.
They're doing that themselves. I'm not painting that way.
They, writ large, are not. I will grant you that there have been some bad messages
in
the party.
Have you had Ted Cruz on this program?
I don't think we have had him.
Well, anybody who has had Ted Cruz on there is essentially advertising that as the spokesperson for the Republican Party. Now, if the Republicans want to say it's not so, let them have the spine to stand up to that. I haven't seen any of that.
Republicans like me stand up to that all the time. There are plenty of Republicans.
I can't figure out how you're a Republican.
Who are rational?
After you just said.
Well, I am.
I would think they would alienate a lot of that party.
There are plenty of fiscal conservatives who are strong on national security. I happen to be pro-life, who are not the radical anti-everyone that you paint them as.
I used to get 35% of all the Republican vote when I was running for office because I was pro-business. This is not the same Republican Party that my father
was. But these are Republicans that were elected to do exactly what they're doing. These are Republicans whose constituents don't like Obamacare. What would you have them do? Break promises?
At the same time, they don't want to shut down the government over Obamacare. That's the problem. They may not like Obamacare, but the American people do not want the government to shut down over it. Get over this. It's the law of the land.
And thank God we continued to fight over them.
As the independent here, I'm fiscally conservative and I'm socially liberal.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I can't fit into either party.
Well, that's fine.
Socially liberal too.
Okay, we've all laid out our
positions. You're not a real Democrat.
We've all just decided to start our own party.
But wait, we can't let either of you go yet.
Governor, you should be lining up with me then, not with the Democrats.
Wait, quickly, yes or no? Are you running for president in 2016?
No.
Are you?
Maybe.
Oh, maybe. Okay, thanks to Howard Dean and Jesse Ventura. We'll be right back.
Well, I'd say it's been a pretty good show.
Absolutely.
Got a little hot.
Fiery.
The debate continues online at CNN.